This will be more clearer. You are telling better.
You won't have the pain. It won't be clearer. Background noise will be there if you talk without mic.
Without mic, it's better to talk without.
Yeah, but you are having pain.
No, that's okay. 1 hour, 1.5 hours, the issue.
So if this goes inside, no, it goes on more your pain.
This will be more clearer.
Upa, sir, there will be some disturbance, okay, this sir, 1.5 hours I'll be going.
I'm going.
Because once I start, it is non-stop 1.5 hours.
I'll just give
my
print, then I'm going. Long session.
Well, 1 hour, 20 minutes.
Oh, I think so, sir, posted in the group.
Yeah, same thing, same.
I think it's better in
the
group.
Mic is on. Okay.
Is your mic on? That is
See, I related to
darker. We'll have to shift you, but the cable might not reach.
Mm-hmm. Shift to where?
That side, just below the lid. But I don't know if cable will
change. Different difference.
very good model. All the students and all the life members of Indian Society of Periodontology who have joined here for yet another session of rapid review course for postgraduate students. I welcome you all for today's lecture. Today's lecture is on periodontal management
for my
patient.
You want to see.
For today's lecture, we have a revered teacher, a very senior member of Indian Society of Periodontology, Dr. Biju Thomas, sir. He is a professor and head of A.P. Shetty Memorial Institute of Dental Sciences, Mangalore. Welcome, sir, and over to you for your scientific lecture, sir. Thank you.
So, thank you, Neeraj. Now, good morning and a warm welcome to all the office bearers, the life members, and the associate members of the Indian Society of Periodontology who have gathered here today for yet another webinar series, a very successful program that has been running for the last month and a half now. Before starting this presentation, I should specially thank our Madam President Nymphia Pandit and Honorable Secretary Grover, sir, who took the initiative for this program. And it goes to their credit that they've been able to successfully run it with good patronage and good attendance for the various programs. Now, of course, I cannot forget the man Friday behind this program, Dr. Neeraj, who has been single-handedly shouldering the responsibility of taking this program forward. You can see him in every webinar with a pleasant smile of his, patiently ironing out all the technical glitches that occur in between and seeing that this program goes on smoothly. Now, I understand from the organizers that there are even periodontists from outside the country who are logging in for this ISP webinar series. That goes to show how strong and vibrant a society, the Indian Society of Periodontology is, and I'm proud that I'm one of its members and office bearers. Now, when Madam President called me up about 2-3 weeks back and told me, like, Biju, you take up this topic of periodontal management of medically compromised patients, my first reaction was, I'll get back to you tomorrow, I said, because in my mind, what was going on was that, after all, what is there in this topic? Yeah, it is important from the exam point of view, I agree, because this is a usually asked question in paper 3 as a 45-minute essay, even if the olden days when we had a single essay in paper 4, the 3-hour paper, this has frequently come as a question, the periodontal management of medically compromised patients. But more than being from the exam point of view, when I thought in depth, I realized that this topic is important for you from the day-to-day clinical practice also. Now, most of you are logging into this program of postgraduate students. Now, their third years, couple of months down the line, you will graduate from budding periodontist to full-fledged periodontist. Even the second year PGs, a year down the line, you're going to be periodontist. But those who are in our country, that is, who are working in India, face things squarely that most of you are going to be clinicians. You may be busy consultants handling a lot of cases, but keep in mind, today we'll come across a lot of medically compromised patients in our day-to-day practice, and it is imperative that we understand what they are suffering from and the precautions to be taken in their periodontal management. See, I was talking to some of my students who are in Western countries, who are practicing Western countries. What they told me was, sir, if you make a major mistake in your practice in the Western countries, probably you are finished. In the sense that not only will the patient sue you for a hefty compensation, you that also may be the virtually the end of your career. Luckily, even in India, we are not reached to that extent. But keep in mind, gone are the days where the patient used to look up to the doctor as a god. Today, if you make a mistake, for example, you do not recognize a medical problem that the patient is suffering from, and you go ahead with a periodontal treatment and some complications develop, patient will definitely demand compensation from you. He'll expect you to answer for the mistakes you have made. So it is imperative that we have a good working knowledge. Of course, we are not going to treat the medical condition, but at least we should be aware of what is the problem and how to go about it. In other words, if you're carrying out periodontal treatment, whatever type of periodontal treatment, whether it is surgical or non-surgical therapy, how we are going to manage the patient. I am from the Abhi Shetty Memorial Institute of Dental Sciences. Many of you may be familiar with this institution. It's one of the premier institutions in the country. It's a 35-year-old institution, and I've been working here for the last quarter century plus. Now, if you go through literature, there are plenty of studies on the interrelationship between peroral disease and systemic diseases. At the beginning of my presentation itself, I'd like to make one thing very clear. This lecture is not going to be about periosystemic interrelationship. We already had an excellent lecture. Dr. Ashish Jain has covered part of this under his presentation on cardiovascular disease and peroral diseases. My presentation will be basically on the various medical conditions and the peroral management of the same. It will not be in any way connected to periosystemic interrelationships. Now, I'll be covering this topic under the following headings, that is cardiovascular diseases, endocrine disorders, hematological, management of the female patient, the pulmonary diseases, the renal disorders, the liver diseases, cancer and immunotherapy patients, the neurological disorders, and the infectious diseases. Coming to the first one, that is the cardiovascular diseases. Now, today, those of you who are in practice will know, we come across several patients on a day-to-day basis who are suffering from a variety of cardiovascular conditions. So this can range from hypertension to ischemic heart disease, dysarrhythmias, infective endocarditis, etc. Literature tells us that globally millions of people die every year because of cardiovascular related complications. And as far as we are concerned, these patients can be problematic to us in terms of oral complications, that is the dental therapy and the emergency care that may be required in case a complication occurs in your dental office during a treatment. We'll take up each one by one. Hypertension is referred to as the silent killer because it affects, even in the US alone, they say at least 18 million adults are affected by it. This was the older classification of hypertension, where they said the normal blood pressure is around 120 by 80. But recently, the American College of Cardiologists and the American Heart Association has modified this. They have reduced the guidelines for 2014 to less than 120 by 80. So even 110 by 70 today is considered as normal. Of course, it varies from system to system, because when I saw the literature, I realized that the European Society of Cardiologists, they take 140 by 90 as a hypertension, but the American College of Cardiologists and the American Heart Association recommends 130 by 80 as a hypertensive patient. So in the newer guideline, they have an elevated category, the stage 1 and the stage 2 category, and the hypertensive crisis. The difference from the older classification was, in the newer classification, they eliminated the category of pre-hypertension. Now, when you talk of risk factors for hypertension, you can go on and on. It starts with age and ethnicity, smoking, high salt intake, health problems, inactive lifestyle, alcohol, high stress levels, obesity. The list is numerous. Now, coming to the hypertensive drugs that the patient takes and their possible dental side effects, most of the patients on hypertensive drugs, they'll be on beta blockers, example, statinol, labetalol. Then they may be on the ACE inhibitors, that is angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors. Under that, you have the acupril, captopril, etc. Angiotensin II receptor blockers, that candesartan, telmisartan, etc. And commonly calcium channel blockers, because they are famous for causing gingival enlargements, closely related to our specialty, amlodipine, nifedipine, verapamil, etc. Now, what are the drug interactions that we expect with the patients who are on antihypertensive drugs? If you see the right, third column on the right, most of this, they talk about NSAIDs as a drug interaction. This is because we know that the non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs inhibit the cyclooxygenase enzymes and prevent prostaglandin synthesis. It is said that these NSAIDs can have adverse drug reactions with the antihypertensive drugs, leading to increase in blood pressure and thus worsening the cardiovascular condition. The literature tells us that the concomitant use of NSAIDs along with angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors or even the angiotensin receptor blockers or the diuretics can even precipitate acute renal failure, hyponatremia or hyperkalemia, especially in the elderly people. So one common thing which you have to keep in mind is be careful when prescribing NSAIDs to patients who are hypertensive. Now, this is an age-old issue that we have been hearing from the time we were students 30 years back also, that can local anesthetics with vasoconstrictors be given in cardiovascular compromised patients. What the American Heart Association and the American Dental Association have said, that the maximum dose of epinephrine in local anesthesia for a healthy subject is about 0.2 mg. But in patients with the severe cardiovascular diseases, that is ASA 3 and 4, ASA refers to the American Society of Anesthesiologists grading. They have a grading from 1 to 5. For example, 3 is patients with severe systemic disease, ASA 4 is patients with severe systemic disease with constant threat to life, and ASA 5 is patients with severe systemic disease with constant threat to life and the patient is not expected to survive. So normally 3 and 4 patients can be treated, and so they say up to 0.4 mg can be given in such patients. Or in other words, the ampules of lignocaine that we use with epinephrine 1:1 lakh concentration, less than 4 ampules of this can be given in a hypertensive patient. Now, what are the dental management of these hypertensive patients? See that the patients are free of stress and anxiety. Short morning appointments should be scheduled. If required, pre-medication should be given if the patients are extra anxious about their procedures. Obtain a good local anesthetic effect before starting your treatment. Avoid the use of epinephrine impregnated gingival traction cords. Consider periodic intraoperative blood pressure monitoring, especially patients who are stage 2 hypertension and above. And terminate the dental treatment immediately if the blood pressure rises above 179 by 109. Another thing we have to keep in mind in managing these patients is they can develop orthostatic hypotension. So suddenly patient getting up from the dental chair, he can have giddiness and collapse. So slow positional changes are required in these patients. Coming to the next condition, that is the cardiac arrhythmias, is described as an abnormality in the rate, rhythms, and site of origin of the cardiac impulse. Sorry, I missed out a slide. The second condition we are talking about is about the heart failure. Heart failure is nothing but definition is simple. The incapacity of the heart to function properly, pumping insufficient blood towards the tissues, leads to fluid accumulation within the lungs, liver, and peripheral tissues. Keep in mind that most of these patients who are having heart failure, they'll be on digitalis drug, which digitalis is a cardiac glycoside which directly works on the heart muscles to strengthen the muscles and regulate the heartbeat. So the dental management of such patients, again, take a thorough history, look for signs and symptoms. Patients who are not on treatment for the heart failure or untreated or uncontrolled defer all periodontal treatments, refer to the physician. Always schedule short, stress-free appointments, same like what we saw for hypertension. Be careful for orthostatic hypotension occurring. So assist the patient into and out of the dental chair, and the supine position may not be tolerated. So such patients should be encouraged to be in a semi-supine or upright chair position. Avoid the use of NSAIDs. We have already seen that in the previous slides. And nitric oxide oxygen sedation can be used with a minimum of 30% oxygen. Now coming to the third point, that is cardiac arrhythmias, is described as abnormality in the rate, regularity, and site of origin of the cardiac impulse. If you suspect a patient is having a cardiac arrhythmia during your periodontal treatment procedure, immediately suspend the procedure, provide oxygen, assess the patient's vitals, that is the BP, pulse, etc. Most of these patients will be carrying their nitrates with them, so advise them to use the one tablet sublingually. Patient should be placed in the Trendelenburg position, that is fully supine with the feet 15 to 30 degree elevated above the head, and anxiolytics can be given such patients to lessen the stress and anxiety. Keep in mind that many of these patients may be having pacemakers. Nowadays, the pacemakers are resistant to electromagnetic interference, Nevertheless, caution should be used when using electrical devices. The next is on infective endocarditis. In infective endocarditis, what happens is the blood-borne bacteria lodge on the endocardium, that is endothelium near the anatomic defects, resulting in bacterial endocarditis. If you are carrying out any periodontal procedures involving the mucosal surfaces, the contaminated tissue can cause transient bacteremia, and this rarely persists for more than 15 minutes. And literature tells us that Streptococcus viridans, that is alpha hemolytic streptococci, is the most common cause of endocarditis following these dental procedures. Now, this is a chart showing the frequency of bacteremia associated with various procedures that we carry out. You see, periodontal surgery, they are reported bacteremia of 36 to 88%. Even a non-surgical procedure like root planing, 8 to 80%, they have reported. Use of toothpicks, 20 to 40%. Even subgingival irrigation devices, 7 to 50%. The procedures that we carry out in the oral cavity, including chewing of food, can cause transient bacteremia. Now, endocarditis protocol in patients, which are the patients in whom the endocarditis prophylaxis is indicated? See, simple procedures like local anesthetic injections, placement of rubber dams, suture removal, etc., you can avoid the endocarditic prophylaxis, but in surgical procedures, periodontal surgery, including root planing, recall maintenance, implant placement, subgingival placement of local drug delivery systems, etc., you have to have a endocarditic prophylaxis before starting the treatment. Now, what are the drugs that you can give for these patients? When we were students, we had a different protocol. They used to say 1.5 gram amoxicillin followed by 500 milligram every 8th hourly, but nowadays the procedure is simple. Single dose of amoxicillin, 2 grams, 30 to 60 minutes before the procedure. Patient who is unable to take oral medication can think of ampicillin or cefoxolin. Even allergic to penicillins, clindamycin, azithromycin can be considered. Next is about the ischemic heart diseases. It is defined as a partial or total reduction in coronary blood flow. Angina is the condition which occurs when the coronary occlusion is partial and no myocardial necrosis occurs in this condition, whereas acute myocardial infarction is observed when the coronary occlusion is total and results in necrosis. Usually in acute MI, the plaque will crack and a blood clot will block the heart. So dental management of such patients, if the patients are anxious, pre-medication of 5 to 10 milligram diazepam can be given, started even the night before, and can be again continued 1 to 2 hours before the treatment. Preferable to keep a patient in a semi-supine position, not in a completely supine position. Blood pressure and pulse oximetric monitoring should be done before and during the dental treatment. Patients on antiplatelet medication, you can expect excessive bleeding to occur, so you should have the local bleeding measures in place, hemostatic measures in place to control the bleeding, like bone wax, sutures, regenerated oxidized cellulose, collagen, even antifibrinolytic agents like tranexamic acid should be in place. Coming to the next condition, that is the patients with cardiac pacemakers and implantable cardioverter, that is a defibrillator. Now, a pacemaker is used to control abnormal heart rhythms and basically uses electric pulse for the heart to beat at a normal rate. Whereas a defibrillator restores a normal heartbeat by sending an electric shock to the heart. Basically, the defibrillator is a battery-powered device placed under your skin and connected to your heart by one or more wires and keeps track of your heartbeat. The dental management in these patients, keep in mind the patient is having other the pacemakers attached to him. So make sure that you are in a very clear, sterilized working environment. There should not be any chance for infection to occur. Oral prophylaxis can be done using hand scalers, although literature tells us that even piezoelectric scalers are safe. However, take care not to place electric cords over the patient's chest. If the patient has an unshielded pacemaker, it should be covered with a lead apron. And more important than all these things is observe the patient for signs and symptoms of pacemaker malfunction, like difficulty in breathing, lightheadedness, dizziness, change in pulse rate, swelling in the chest and arm, chest pain, etc. If you notice any of these symptoms, immediately discontinue the treatment and call for medical help, and the cardiologist should be consulted immediately. Now, next is patients on anticoagulant therapy. Keep in mind, most of the cardiac patients will be on anticoagulant therapy. So the international normalized ratio should be looked into when, for such patients, the normal INR expected is 1, but patients on anticoagulant treatment, it can usually target the INR between 2 and 3. And in certain high-risk situations, like, for example, patient is having a mechanical mitral valve processes, 2.5 to 3 and 3.5 INR values may be okay. Another thing you have to keep in mind is warfarin, which is commonly used by these patients, can interact with several drugs, causing derangement of the anticoagulant function. As of today, the literature tells us that 3 drugs, especially the phenylbutazone, which is an anti-inflammatory drug, the sulfentrazone, which is given for serious disorders, and greasefulvin, which is an antibiotic, have definite evidence of interaction with warfarin. And of these 3, phenylbutazone and sulfentrazone results in potentiation of the warfarin effect, whereas greasefulvin inhibits the warfarin effect. Coming to the next, the dental management of these patients on anticoagulants, keep in mind for majority of outpatient procedures, there's no need to discontinue the oral anticoagulants, but there may be a risk of slight increase in bleeding. So you should have local hemostatic measures in place to control the bleeding. Even after the use of oxidized cellulose, wax, gel, sponge, etc., patient can be prescribed the 5% transeximic acid mouthwashes, that is a POS mouthwash, which is available in the market 4 times a day for 2 days. Only contraindication mainly you have to keep in mind is these patients should not be prescribed non-selective, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs and COX-2 inhibitors for analgesia following dental surgery. So that is about the cardiovascular diseases. So in a nutshell, patients with a wide variety of cardiovascular diseases are frequently encountered in dental practice. It is important that we have a safe and effective dental management of these patients with a good coordination and cooperation between the medical and dental fraternity. And as periodontists, we should have a working knowledge on the progression of the disease, the drugs used in the treatment of the cardiovascular disorders, and its potential hazards should be clearly understood. And more important than this, the periodontist must be able to identify any medical emergency that can occur during a practice and adopt opportune measures to quickly and effectively treat. So that was about the cardiovascular diseases. The next is about the endocrine disorders. Now, we know that the endocrine system is responsible for hormonal secretion, is closely related to the central nervous system. It controls its functions through the hypothalamus and pituitary glands. When I talk of endocrine disorders, the most common ones which we come across are the diabetes mellitus and the thyroid disorders. So today in this lecture, I'll be just focusing on these 2 conditions. Now, diabetes mellitus, now we are all very familiar with this. Today, there is a lot of literature on the interrelationship between diabetes mellitus and periodontal diseases. In fact, this is a favorite question in the exams also. That is the interrelationship between diabetes mellitus and a 2-way relationship. Diabetes mellitus and periodontal disease. In almost every year question paper, if you see, this question will be there. But again, as I said in the beginning, my talk is not about periosystemic interrelationship. Today, I'll just confine to the various diabetic complications and the periodontal management. So when you come to the definition, the International Diabetes Federation has given a very simple definition, that is a chronic disease that arises from the pancreas, does not produce enough insulin, and body cannot effectively use the insulin it produces. But Carranza has given a little more detailed definition, in the sense it describes it as a chronic metabolic disorder characterized by chronic hyperglycemia, diminished insulin production, impaired insulin action, or a combination of both, which result in the inability of glucose to be transported from the bloodstream into the tissues, which in turn results in high blood glucose levels and excretion of sugar in the urine. The WHO has given a good classification of diabetes cases. The type 1 diabetes can be due to beta cell destruction leading to absolute insulin deficiency. It can also be autoimmune or idiopathic. The type 2 diabetes can range from predominantly insulin resistant with relative insulin deficiency to a secretory defect with or without insulin resistance. The other specific types include The genetic forms of diabetes, drug or chemically induced, it can be secondary to steroid use also, unknown etiology where patients do not fit into any of these categories, gestational diabetes which occurs at the first onset or recognition during pregnancy, and also a not strictly diabetes category, that is where they have impaired glucose metabolism, but it is the levels are not high enough to be classified as a diabetic case. Now, these are the classic symptoms which a patient will complain of, that he is drinking enough water but still feeling thirsty, you're paying more than usual, the eyesight is blurry, you feel starved, even though you just ate, you're getting more infections like urinary tract infections, you're losing weight without even trying for it, and you're exhausted no matter how much you sleep or. So most of the cases of diabetes fall in these two categories, the type 1 and 2, and in this, the type 2 is the predominantly cases are seen under type 2. So then type 1 usually under the age of 30, rapid onset, it can occur in normal or even underweight individuals. Little or no insulin is produced. Ketosis is common in these cases. Some books say up to 15% of cases, but I have even seen literature saying 8 to 10%. And autoimmune plus environmental factors are said to be the causative factors, low familial factor, and usually treated with insulin, diet, and exercise. Type 2 diabetes, again, over the age of 40, that is middle age, gradual onset, most of the individuals are overweight and have insulin resistance. Ketosis is usually rare in these cases, make up the vast majority of diabetic cases, and it is part of the metabolic insulin resistance syndrome. And it can be, it has a strong hereditary background and can be treated with initially with diet and exercise, progressing to oral hypoglycemics, and then later on, if the condition gets more severe, you'll have to go for insulin. Today, we have a terminology called as type 3 diabetes also, which is a proposed term for Alzheimer's disease resulting from insulin resistance. Gestational diabetes, again, leads to high blood glucose levels in the mother, brings extra glucose to the baby, can cause the baby to put on extra weights. So this condition has to be correctly diagnosed and treated on time, because it can even be fatal. We have heard of fatalities occurring due to gestational diabetes for both the mother and the child. Now, diagnostic criteria for diabetes, anything fasting plasma glucose levels, anything below 100 milligram per deciliter is said to be normal, whereas anything above 126 is said to be diabetes mellitus. The postprandial glucose level, that is 2 hours after a glucose load, anything less than 140 milligram per deciliter is normal, and anything above 200 is a full-blown diabetes mellitus case. Glycated hemoglobin assays, anything below 5.7 is normal, and anything above 6.5 is said to be a full-blown case of diabetic mellitus. So you can see there's a very narrow range in between a normal individual and a full-blown diabetic case. When we talk of diabetic complications, we have heard of the acute complications like diabetic ketoacidosis, hypoglycemias, and diabetic non-ketotic coma. We also have read in the literature about the various microvascular complications like retinopathy, neuropathy, nephropathy, diabetic foot. We have also read about the macrovascular complications like cerebrovascular, the cardiovascular, and the peripheral vascular complications. Now, we'll be focusing mainly on the oral complications of diabetes. We are fully aware of the fact many times it is we periodontists and dental surgeons who are first diagnose a case of diabetes. Because when a patient comes to us saying that I have got a foul taste in the mouth, I've got halitosis, my mouth smells. When we examine the patient, you see multiple abscesses in the mouth. So you ask the patient to get at least a random blood sugar examination and come. And my own experience can tell you, I've seen several patients who have come back with a random blood sugar levels of 360, 380, 400, even 450 milligram per deciliter. This is because unlike in the Western countries, in India, we don't have a system of patients going for annual health checkups and all. So a patient may be diabetic for a long period of time without being aware at all about his condition. And in addition to the abscesses, you see sometimes enlarged gingiva, sessile or pedunculated gingival polyps, gingival proliferation, there will be diminished salivary flow, burning mouth syndrome, the tongue also will be, the patient will be having very dry and scaly tongue. And when you come to the microflora, there will be a greater predominance of Candida albicans, hemolytic streptococci, and
staphylococci. So this type of picture, this is a picture of a case which had come to our institution. See the diabetic non-healing ulcer. This is where our clinical acumen comes into the picture. As clinicians, as periodontists, when we see a lesion in the mouth, it can be on any part, it can be on the oral mucosa, on the tongue, even the heart tissues, we should be immediately able to try to identify what it is and at least come to a provisional diagnosis before referring the patient for investigations. Now, coming to the treatment of diabetes, from my interaction with diabetologists, I've understood that in India, most of the patients on diabetes are on the biguanides, that is a metformin class of drugs. It's basically an insulin sensitizer, which reduces the insulin resistance preeminently at the hepatic level. Patients are also on the thiazolidinones, that is a glitazone derivatives. Also, I've seen several patients who are on the sulfonylureas, that is the secretagogues, which stimulate insulin secretion. Keep in mind, many of the patients who are on oral hypoglycemic are not on a single drug, they are on a combination of drugs. So your common diabetic treatment will start with your monitoring the glucose at home using a home glucose meter. Then initial mild type 2 cases may be able to manage with diet and exercise alone. That is what they say is you have to break a sweat. So it will be beneficial to keep the blood sugar levels under control. Later on, for type 2 diabetes, you may be able to manage with oral medication, but type 1 diabetes patients definitely need insulin via an injection or an insulin pump or an inhaler. Now, what are our treatment considerations, dental treatment consideration in diabetic patients? We can carry out all procedures, periodontal procedures in patients who are diabetic if they are a controlled diabetic. It is better in long-standing diabetic cases, be in contact with the patient's physician and get informed consent, especially carrying out any mucolingual surgical procedures. Antibiotic prophylaxis will be needed if it is an uncontrolled diabetic and you are going for some emergency treatment protocols. So what is the antibiotic prophylaxis suggested for diabetic patients? Amoxicillin 2 grams 1 hour prior to surgery and 500 milligram orally every 8th hour. Even augmenting, that is amoxicillin plus clavulanic acid, can be given in the as a loading dose, 2 grams of amoxicillin with 125 mg of clavulanic acid, and as an adult dose, 500 mg with 125 mg, that is the augmented 625, which you get in the market. What are the emergencies you have to look for in diabetic patients? Diabetic complications can be hypoglycemia and hyperglycemia. Hypoglycemia especially is caused in patients who take insulin. Suddenly the blood sugars may drop. Patient may have a pale, sweaty skin, headache, dizziness, nausea, palpitation, tachycardia, confused, drowsiness, speech difficulty, convulsions, or even unconsciousness can occur. Hyperglycemia, again, ketone breath is a giveaway for hyperglycemia. Again, the same, many other symptoms may be there, like lethargy, blurred vision, dehydration, dry skin, weight loss, hyperventilation, etc. So hypoglycemia, to be careful, insulin patients, these are the standard symptoms that the patient will report with, that is sweating, pallor, irritability, hunger, lack of coordination, etc. And if the patient is conscious, a hypoglycemic patient can be given sugar, glucose, or a sweet drink, and continue giving the sugars every 15 minutes till the patient recovers, and follow it up with a light snack like a sandwich, loosen the tight clothing, and if there is no improvement, probably you'll have to call for emergency backup. Whereas a patient has become unconscious due to hypoglycemia, immediately give 50 ml of 50% IV glucose through a large vein. And as soon as the patient recovers consciousness, start oral carbohydrate intake. Otherwise, 5 to 10% glucose infusion will have to be continued till the patient recovers consciousness. Intramuscular injection of 1 ml of glucagon can also be given in this patient. Keep in mind that if the patient does not regain consciousness, then you can even suspect cerebral edema to occur, and it is better you immediately call for medical help. Western countries, they expect many clinics as well as patients to be having a diabetic emergency kit with them, which includes the emergency snacks, the testing kits, etc. So that is about diabetic mellitus. Next, we'll come to the adrenal insufficiency conditions. This is nothing but a disease state caused by insufficient levels of glucocorticoids or mineralocorticoids. The symptoms which a patient presents with are fatigue, lassitude, malaise, postural dizziness, and patient will show signs of weight loss, hyperpigmentation, hypotension, thinning of axillary and pubic hair, and vitiligo. Now, when you talk of diagnostic criteria for this, the two things you have to keep in mind are the cortisol levels and the adrenocorticotropic hormone levels. Now, cortisol is a steroid hormone which is secreted by the adrenal glands. It is important for regulating glucose, protein, and lipid metabolism, and also for suppressing the immune system's response. This also helps to maintain the blood pressure. And normal, when you talk of cortisol level, there's a broad range of values, with the highest values in the morning, that is 10 to 20 microgram per deciliter, going down to 3 to 10 by evening and least at bedtime. And the high cortisol levels suggest Cushing syndrome, and low levels of cortisol will suggest that the patient may be suffering from Addison's disease. Now, coming to the ACTH, the adrenocorticotropic hormone is a hormone that stimulates the production of cortisol. And normal, and just like cortisol, it has a broad range of values with 10 to 50 picogram per ml in the morning time, going down to 20 picogram per ml at 4 p.m. and as less as 5 to 10 picogram in the night. Now, when you talk of patients on steroids today, in your day-to-day practice, you will come across plenty of patients who are on corticosteroid therapy. This is because corticosteroids have numerous applications in treating inflammation and disease of the immune system based on their significant anti-inflammatory and immunosuppressive effects that they have. There are a variety of drugs which are known to interact with corticosteroids, including blood thinners like warfarin, antifungal drugs, even phenobarbitone, phenytoin sodium, rifampin. All these drugs can have interaction with blood cortisol because they increase the breakdown of corticosteroids by the liver. And this may necessitate an increase of corticosteroid dose when they are used in combination with these drugs. So we should be taking a good medical history. We should understand whether the patient is taking hydrocortisone. There are several patients who are on betamethasone, dexamethasone, prednisolone, especially triamcinolone. So all this should be correctly documented in our practice. So the dental considerations for patients: conduct treatment preferably in the early mornings. Anxiety and emotional stress should be controlled for the patients. Use long-acting anesthetics. Keep the use of NSAIDs to the minimum and keep a proper aseptic working condition. Your surgical area should be aseptic free, and antibiotic prophylaxis is preferred in these patients. Now, coming to the thyroid and parathyroid glands. Now, this is a picture to indicate how the calcium homeostasis is maintained in our body. See, if the calcium levels are high in our body, the thyroid gland releases calcitonin. It brings down the calcium by increasing calcium deposition in the bones, decreasing calcium uptake in the intestines, and decreasing the reabsorption of calcium from the urine by the kidneys. This will lead to fall in the calcium levels to normal levels. Conversely, if the calcium levels are too low, the parathyroid gland releases the parathyroid hormone. This has the opposite effect, that is, it increases calcium release from the bone and increases uptake of calcium in the intestines and reabsorption from the kidneys. This is how the calcium homeostasis is maintained in the body. So these are the typical signs of hypothyroidism and hyperthyroidism. One difference, if you can see the first point, hypothyroidism, generally they have an intolerance to cold, whereas hyperthyroidism, there's an intolerance to heat. Other than that also, there are a lot of differences. Like in hypothyroidism, you have receding hairline, eyelid edema, dull blank expression, hair loss, apathy, lethargy, dry skin, brittle nails. Whereas in hyperthyroidism, you have bulging eyes, facial flushing, tachycardia, increased systolic blood pressure, breast enlargement, weight loss, muscle wastings, etc. Now, when you talk of diagnostic values or reference values for assessing the thyroid function, the two tests that come to our mind are the T3, the T4, and also the TSH. Now, the thyroid gland produces a hormone called as triiodothyronin, which is otherwise referred to as T3, the reference value for which is 0.58 to 1.59 nanogram per ml. The thyroid gland also produces a hormone called thyroxin, which is referred to as T4. Both these hormones together regulate our body temperature, the metabolism, and the heart rate. Now, what are the oral manifestations? In hypothyroidism, we may have salivary gland enlargement, compromised perinatal health, macroglossia, glossitis, delayed dental eruptions, microglia, thick lips, mouth breathing, anterior open bite. Whereas in hyperthyroidism, you have increased susceptibility to perinatal disease, enlargement of extraganglionar thyroid tissue, burning mouth syndrome, accelerated dental eruption, and maxillary and mandibular osteoporosis, etc. So if a patient is having hypercalcemia, because we talked about the regulation of calcium in the body, the patient will complain of bone pain, arrhythmias, cardiac arrest, kidney stones, muscle weakness, and excessive urination. Whereas a patient is having hypocalcemia, patient will be showing convulsions, arrhythmias, tetany, stridor, and spasms. Keep in mind, hypothyroidism, patients who are suffering from hypothyroidism are sensitive to most of the drugs that we prescribe, especially the CNS depressant drugs, sedatives, anti-anxiety drugs, etc. So in such patients, avoid the following categories of drugs, that is sedatives and anxiolytics, the opioids, and also the CNS depressants should be avoided in such patients as moderate to severe overdose reactions can develop following administration of normal dose of these drugs. That is about the endocrine disorders. We'll come to the third part, that is the hematological diseases. Now, coming to contents, we'll cover the hematological disorders under disorders of red blood cells, the white blood cells, the acquired, as well as the congenital bleeding disorders. So, when you talk of red blood cell disorders, the first thing that comes to our mind is anemia. Anemias are defined as a reduction in the oxygen carrying capacity of the blood, usually associated with an increased number of circulating RBCs and an abnormality in the hemoglobin contained within the RBCs. Literature tells us that anemia is a system complex resulting from basically three causes. It can be either due to decreased production of RBCs, it can be due to blood loss or increased rate of destruction of the circulating RBCs. The types of anemia we have seen in the literature about microcytic anemias, under which comes the iron deficiency anemias, the thalassemias, and lead poisoning. Then you have the normocytic anemias, under which comes the hemolytic anemia, the sickle cell anemias, the glucose 6 phosphate dehydrogenase deficiencies, the aplastic anemias, and anemias of chronic disease. Then you have microcytic anemias, where you have the pernicious anemias, the folate deficiencies, and hypothyroidism. So again, I was talking earlier about your clinical acumen. You see, examining a patient, you see a tongue like this, very pale white color. Immediately suspect the patient is suffering from iron deficiency anemia. Ask for an investigation to be done, and many a time these patients will come back with values of 6 and 7. Pernicious anemia. Typical presentation is a red beefy tongue. Now, coming to clinical presentation, anemic patients can complain about lethargy, palpitation, shortness of breath, abdominal and bone pain, irritability, dizziness, tingling of finger and toes, and muscle weakness. It's not that all these symptoms are present in every patient, but one or more of these may be present in different patients. Now, specific to iron deficiency anemias, patient will have impaired immunity resistance to infection, diminished exercise tolerance and work performance. Whereas patients with glucose 6 phosphate deficiency anemias, they can involve acute intravascular hemolysis. Sickle cell anemia is a rather dangerous condition. We should be careful of patients who are having sickle cell anemia in their dental management. Such patients will be having jaundice, pallor, leg ulcers, organomegaly, cardiac failure, stroke, and delays in growth and development. So first and foremost, take a detailed history to identify the conditions associated with anemia. Questions concerning dietary intake, malnutrition, alcohol or drug use should be looked into. Even the use of NSAIDs, menstrual blood loss, pregnancies, hypothyroidism, all this should be recorded in detail. Even family history is important, because it will help to identify the hereditary risk for hemolytic anemias. And children, the history should identify the patterns of growth. Now, many a time, just like we said for the previous condition also, many a, like diabetes, even for anemia, we may, the periodontist may be the first one to identify signs and symptoms of anemia in patients. Because when they present to us for dental treatment, see the tongue, you will make out how it is, the why I showed you the picture of the pale white tongue, or it may just see the two hands in this picture. You can make out how pale the hand on the left side is looking there. Again, it's the giveaway that the patient is suffering from anemia. So such patient should be immediately referred to a clinician, a physician for appropriate follow-up. So what are the recommendations in anemia patients? To minimize the risk of medical complications, what Western literature tells us is that hemoglobin level should be above 11 grams per deciliter and the patient should be free of symptoms. But I do not agree with this in the sense that in India, we see plenty of patients who have hemoglobin levels of 8.5, 9, 9.5 for years together without absolutely no problem walking around. In fact, a lot of ladies I have seen, their hemoglobin levels are only in the range of about 9.5 to 10. So patients who are short of breath, but keep in mind, if the patient is short of breath and if the hemoglobin levels are less than 11 gram per deciliter, and if the patient is having abnormal heart rate or an oxygen saturation less than 91%, or in other words, if the patient is having other complications, then such patients are considered as medically unstable and routine treatment should be deferred until their health status improves. Now, anemic patients with glucose 6-phosphate dehydrogenase deficiency, keep in mind these patients have increased incidence of drug sensitivity with sulfonamides, aspirin, chloramphenicol, even other antibiotics like penicillin, streptomycin, isoniazide, etc. And the dental infections, be careful if dental infections occur in these patients, like for example, a periodontal abscess, because the rate of hemolysis can be accelerated. So such patients should be emphasize about the importance of maintaining a good oral hygiene and preventing the occurrence of dental infections. If at all the dental infection occurs, it should be managed effectively, but keep in mind all the drugs which I talked about in the previous part of the slide, they should not be used in these patients. Sickle cell anemia, I told you, is a rather serious condition which we should be careful about, because it can be fatal if not managed and kept in within reasonable levels. What the contraindications in sickle cell anemia include, mainly the first and foremost, the high dose of salicylate should not be used in pain control, because it is said that the salicylates have the potential for acidosis and can trigger a sickle crisis, and therefore you can use acetaminophen with or without codeine for pain control. And they even say that morphine is considered the drug of choice in management of acute sickle cell pain. But if you're carrying out any periodontal surgical procedures, better to do it under prophylactic antibiotic cover. If not allergic, penicillin can be the drug of choice, and preferably IM or an IV route is preferred in such patients. So what are the treatment planning modifications in anemic patients? If it is a mild anemia, it is okay. Only in severe anemias or the sickle cell type of anemia, you should have adequate treatment planning modification in place. All elective procedures should be avoided in patients with sickle cell anemia. Even routine treatment can be given for patients only in those who are in a non-crisis state, with special emphasis on oral hygiene measures. Prevent gingival inflammation, infections, etc. And regular pulse oximetric monitoring should be done during the surgical periodontal treatment of patients with anemia. Coming to disorders of white blood cells. Disorders of white blood cells, you have the myeloproliferative disorders and the lymphoproliferative disorders. The myeloproliferative disorders can include the acute myeloid leukemias and the chronic myeloid leukemias. The lymphoproliferative disorders can include the acute lymphoblastic leukemia, the chronic lymphocytic leukemias, and the lymphomas. Of course, multiple myeloma also comes under this category. The lymphomas, you have the Hodgkin's lymphoma, the non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, and the Burkitt's lymphoma. Cyclic neutropenia is also included in the category of WBC disorders. Coming to leukemia, Leukemia is the simplest definition is the like cancer of the white blood cells. It affects the bone marrow and circulating blood. Cause is largely unknown, but they say you are at increased risk if you are exposed to large doses of ionizing radiation, chemicals, infection with viruses, especially the Epstein-Barr virus and the human lymphotropic virus, and cigarette smoking, exposure to electromagnetic fields, etc., put you at increased risk. Now, coming to the dental considerations, gingival enlargement with inflammation and infiltration of atypical and immature white blood cells is a hallmark of leukemias. It is said that up to 36% of those with acute leukemia, especially the acute myelomonocytic type, and about 10% with chronic leukemia show gingival enlargement. And many a time, in association with the gingival enlargement, the oral hygiene will be poor. So what happens is, a combination of this, the poor oral hygiene with the gingival enlargement will contribute to increased gingival bleeding and halitosis. And this gingival bleeding can also get exacerbated by the presence of thrombocytopenia. So adequate plaque control measures like use of chlorhexidine mouthwashes and chemotherapy should be used to promote resolution of this condition. So you see this picture of an acute myeloid leukemia. You can see the ecchymosis of the tongue. Even a picture down, the leukemic infiltrate in a patient with acute myeloid leukemia just above the central incision, so you can see. Another patient, acute myelocytic leukemia, the picture is, I hope the picture is clear. You can see the gingival enlargement with poor oral hygiene, bleeding, pus discharge, everything. Now that is about the leukemias. Now when you talk of lymphomas, we talk about the Hodgkin's lymphoma, the non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, and the Burkitt's lymphoma. Now I'm not going into the details of each one because my time I have is limited, but what are the peripheral considerations in patients with leukemia and lymphomas? Look for signs of allergy or bleeding and within 24 to 48 hours after peripheral surgical procedures. And in multiple myeloma patients with renal dysfunction, be careful about the use of acetaminophen, aspirin, and narcotics. Even NSAIDs should be avoided as much as possible. Many of these patients will be having mucositis, which will be painful. So you have to manage it with the use of bland mouth rinses, antihistamine solutions, topical anesthetic gels like Orabase, etc. Any situation where a platelet count is less than 50,000 units per microliter, the platelet transfusion will be needed before peripheral surgical procedures are to be carried out. Again, don't take your own decisions. All these decisions have to be taken by the patient's hematologist only, but these are the general guidelines we are expected to know. Another contraindication is many of these patients with multiple myeloma may have macroglossia, so avoid supine positioning to minimize the risk of airway obstruction. Next, we'll cover the acquired bleeding disorders. When you talk of acquired bleeding disorders, it can occur as a result of disease, drugs, radiation, or even chemotherapy for cancer. This, basically, we have to cover the non-thrombocytopenic purpuras, where you have vascular wall alterations and disorders of platelet function. Then you have the thrombocytopenic purpuras, where you have the primary and secondary. You also have the hypercoagulable states and disorders of coagulation. When you talk of normal control of bleeding, basically, first you have a vascular phase where there's a vasoconstriction which occurs in the area of injury immediately after the injury has occurred, followed by a platelet phase where the platelets and vessel wall become sticky, and this mechanical plug of platelets seals off the opening of cut vessels. And this phase also begins within seconds after injury, followed by a coagulation phase where the blood is lost in the surrounding area and it coagulates through the extrinsic and common pathways. Then later on, the blood in the vessels in the area of injury can coagulate through the intrinsic and common pathways, and this takes place more slowly than the other phases. And the last is the fibrinolytic phase, where there is a release of antithrombotic agents, leads to destruction of antithrombotic agents by the spleen and liver. So when you talk of the various laboratory tests related to hematological disorders, in addition to our regular tests which we carry out, that is the total count, the differential count, the hemoglobin, the bleeding time, the clotting time, these four tests have to be known by each one of us because these are commonly carried out for the various hematological disorders. First and foremost, the prothrombin time. Postprandial time is a blood test that measures how long it takes for the blood to clot. So in other words, this test basically can be used to check for bleeding problems. It also can be referred to as an INR test. Again, the values vary from lab to lab. Normally, what I've seen is a prothrombin time. They talk about anywhere between 60 to 70 seconds. But Western literature, the lab, they talk about 11 to 15 seconds also. Now, what is the second test? This APTT, that is activated partial thromboplastin time. It's a screen. This is a screening test that helps to evaluate a person's ability to appropriately form blood clots. Or in other words, it measures the number of seconds it takes for a clot to form in a sample of blood after reagents are added to it. The reference range for activated partial thromboplastin test is anywhere between 30 to 40 seconds. The third test we have to be aware of is the thrombin test. Now, thrombin test is a blood test that measures the time it takes for a clot to form in the plasma of a blood sample containing anticoagulant after an excess of thrombin has been added to it. Or in other words, it is a screening coagulation test designed to assess the fibrin formation from fibrinogen to plasma. The thrombin time test is usually performed as a next step in the evaluation of abnormally prolonged activated partial thromboplastin time or prothrombin time. So initially the prothrombin time and activated partial thromboplastin time tests are performed. And if you get abnormal values, then you go for the thrombin test. And lastly, what we have to know is the platelet count. The normal platelet count is anywhere between 140,000 to 150,000 to 4 lakh units. Platelets per microliter of blood. More than 450,000 is a condition, we call it as thrombocytosis, and less than 150,000, we refer to it as thrombocytopenia. Now, under this, we also have the cyclic neutropenias under the white blood cell disorders. It is nothing but a periodic decrease that they say there can be up to 40% drop in the number of circulating neutrophils every 21 to 28 days. Now, you can also plan out your practice according to the international normalized value or INR value. The international normalized ratio values. The INR is basically derived from the prothrombin time and it's calculated as a ratio of the patient's prothrombin time to a controlled prothrombin time, which is standardized for the potency of the thromboplastin reagent developed by the WHO. So basically INR equals patient's prothrombin time divided by the controlled prothrombin time. The INR helps to assess the risk of bleeding of a patient. So what they say is 1.5 to 2.4, gingivectomies, multiple quadrant flap surgeries, all these treatments can be done safely, but preferably avoid block anesthesias and local measures may be needed for hemostasis. INR of 2.5 to 2.9, quadrant flap surgeries or reserve can be done. Even non-surgical scaling and root planing can be done. 3 to 3.4 INR, minor surgical procedures, gingivoplasties, etc. can be done, but block anesthesias are not recommended. 3.5 to 4, only minor emergency surgical, minor surgical procedures, which are a real emergency, should be carried out, like incision and drainage of an abscess, etc. And anything INR value above 4, no surgical treatment is indicated under the INR is reduced. What are the treatment planning modifications for patients with bleeding disorders? Proper preparation and protocols, most of the indicated dental treatments can be provided. But keep in mind, if the patient is in terminal phase of a disease, like for example, end-stage leukemia, etc., then such patients in general offer only conservative dental treatment. Avoid use of NSAIDs for pain relief, especially in those who are having bleeding disorders and are receiving anticoagulant medication. The idiopathic thrombocytic purpura, the peril consideration we have to look for is the non-surgical procedure. You can do oral hygiene maintenance toothbrushing, etc., but preferably avoid flossing. Less invasive procedures like supraangular scaling, etc., can be done without a likelihood of bleeding occurring. platelet transfusion is not required normally for such procedures. So if you're doing an scaling and root planing, or you can use scalers and curettes, and ultrasonic instruments are also preferred because they cause less tissue trauma. But many a time these patients will have severely inflamed tissue. So initially go for a gross debridement, get the condition under control with use of mouthwashes, etc. Reduce the tissue inflammation before going in for subgingival procedures. When you talk of anesthesia in such patients, generally avoid nerve blocks because it can lead to hematoma formation. So local infiltration or intralingual anesthesia is preferred. Vasoconstrictors can be used in the LA, but keep in mind a vasoconstrictor in the local anesthetic can cause late bleeding, that is a rebound vasodilatation effect. So this should be kept in mind. But if you're going for surgical procedures, what they say is peridural surgical procedures can be carried out safely if the platelet count is more than 80,000. Some books say minor surgical procedures can be carried out even if it is 50,000, more than 50,000 cells per microliter. But what I suggest is at least 80,000, it should be fine. If it is less than 50,000, definitely platelet transfusion should be done before doing any surgical procedure 30 minutes before the surgery. An alternative line of management is put the patients on oral systemic steroids so that the platelet levels come to safe limits. But the steroid therapy has to be started at least 7 to 10 days before the surgery. Now coming to congenital bleeding disorders, we covered acquired bleeding disorders. Congenital bleeding disorders, we'll mainly concentrate here on hemophilia A and hemophilia B, because these are the two conditions that we commonly come across. Now we know hemophilia A is caused by deficiency or defect of factor 8 inherited as a X-linked recessive trait. And forget the details about the hemophilia A. The clinical presentation we have to keep in mind is patients with severe hemophilia A can bleed extensively even from very small injuries. Hemarthrosis can be developed in such patients, and if the factor 8 concentration is less than 1%, the patient can even have severe spontaneous bleeding. Again, hemarthrosis, ecchymosis, and soft tissue hematomas are common in such patients. Hemophilia B, otherwise referred to as Christmas disease, is factor 9 deficient or defective. And keep in mind, the incidence of hemophilia B is much less than that of hemophilia A, but the clinical manifestations of the two disorders are identical, and even the screening and laboratory tests are the same for both the conditions. How do we manage hemophilia patients? Again, avoid aspirin and NSAIDs. If the patient for pain management, acetaminophen with or without codeine is suggested. We can even give this tramadol tablets, which are available. Avoid block anesthetic injections, mandibular block. We have already seen the reason why blocks have to be avoided, because it can lead to bleeding in that area. Patients placed on factor 8 replacement need to be observed for signs and symptoms of allergy, as they are at great risk for bleeding disorders. And mild to moderate hemophilia can be managed using hemostatics like desmopressin and aminocaproic acid. But if the patient is having severe hemophilia, definitely factor 8 replacements are required. Again, don't take your own decisions and go ahead. Do any treatment only in consultation with the patient's hematologist. Determine if the patient can be managed in the dental office. If not, do the treatment in a medical hospital with all the precautions in place. Excessive bleeding can occur after any peridural surgical procedure is carried out. So you have to use systemic and local means to control the bleeding. And not only that, once the surgical procedure is over, follow up the patient continuously for the next 24 to 48 hours. That is why we say it is better if the patient is hospitalized and the treatment is done. So peridural surgery, root planing, may require factor replacement in patients with severe factor 8 deficiency. However, non-surgical procedures can be carried out, for example, suprangular scaling, but avoid injury to the gingival tissues. Now, the next part of my presentation is on peridural therapy in female patients. All of you will agree with me that a female patient is not a medically compromised condition, just because we have a separate chapter in a book on the peridural management of the female patient. Just to indicate the precautions to be taken in the different life cycle of a female patient, and I hope I will not be branded as an MCP for putting this here, especially since there is no literature on phenol therapy in the male patients. Coming to puberty, they say there is enhanced blood circulation in the N-terminal capillary loops, and there is also increased prevalence of gingivitis and bleeding tendencies. And microflora, there is increase of Pyrotella intermedia and Cactophagus species in puberty. Now, incidence of pubertal gingivitis are seen at the age of 11 to 13 years and commonly seen in the inflammation in the interproximal areas. So that is about puberty. Now, pregnancy gingivitis is commonly associated with marginal gingival enlargements. Literature tells us that the incidence can be as high as 30 to 75%. So this type of picture, you see this picture here, this marginal gingival enlargement, this commonly can be associated with pregnancy, especially in patients whose oral hygiene maintenance is not good. Or you can even go in for a pregnancy tumor. You may come across lesions like this in the pregnancy due to the altered hormonal levels. But understand one thing, that most of these conditions regress after pregnancy. And if it does not regress completely, probably you may have to go for a gingivoplasty or something to correct it. For dental treatment in pregnant women, we have learned that the first trimester avoid x-rays and only emergency treatment should be given. The second trimester is the period where elective dental treatment can be done. And avoid x-rays as far as possible. Even the third trimester, avoid any form of treatment, especially in the second half of the third trimester. Bar control maintenance, oral hygiene maintenance has to be emphasized, because any negligence in the maintenance of oral hygiene will lead to exacerbation of the condition. So these patients have to be taken care of regarding the maintenance of oral hygiene. Scaling and root planing can be performed whenever necessary. Use non-alcohol based oral rinses. Use of prenatal fluorides is controversial, because as of today, the American Dental Association does not recommend the use of prenatal fluorides. When you're doing any dental treatment for a pregnant patient, keep in mind that the woman will be uncomfortable during pregnancy. Supine hypotensive syndrome can occur, especially in a semi-reclined or supine position, as the inferior vena cava will be compressed by the gravid uterus, causing maternal hypotension, decreased cardiac output, and eventual loss of consciousness. So the clinical changes in the peroral tissue during menopause and postmenopause, we come across a reduction in epithelial characterization, reduction in salivary gland flow, drying of the oral tissues, bleeding on probing and even during brushing, altered sensations, etc. Menopausal gingival stomatitis is characterized by atrophic, pale appearing oral mucosa, characterized by gingiva that bleeds easily. And many times the gingiva has a pale, dry, shiny or erythematous appearance. So this type of condition you can see in menopausal gingival stomatitis, especially associated with a poor oral hygiene. Now we'll come to the pulmonary diseases. Pulmonary diseases, chronic obstructive pulmonary diseases are common pulmonary diseases that can cause obstruction in airflow. It includes chronic bronchitis and emphysema, and also chronic lower respiratory disease, asthma. Now, chronic bronchitis is defined as a condition associated with chronic inflammation of the bronchi that produces excessive tracheobronchial mucus production and a persistent cough with sputum for at least 3 months in at least 2 consecutive years in a patient, whereas emphysema is a permanent enlargement of the airspaces of the lung, accompanied by destruction of the airspace walls without obvious fibrosis. Worldwide, the most important cause of COPD is tobacco smoking and environmental pollution. And keep in mind, many of these patients will be on systemic corticosteroid therapy. And such patients may require supplementation of the steroid for surgical procedures because of the adrenal suppression. Avoid macrolide antibiotics like erythromycin, ciprofloxacin in these patients, because these patients will be on theophylline also. And theophylline, these antibiotics can reduce the metabolism of theophylline, resulting in theophylline toxicity. Coming to asthmas, it's a chronic inflammatory disease of the airways characterized by reversible episodes of increased airway hyperresponsiveness. Results in recurrent episodes of dyspnea, cough, and wheezing. Said that the bronchial lung tissue of patients with asthma is very sensitive to a variety of stimuli. So the signs and symptoms include shortness of breath, dry cough, wheezing, chest pain. The irritants that can cause asthma can include household chemicals, dust, fatty foods, alcohol, viruses, pets, even pollution. Now, forget about that. What we are more concerned about is if an emergency asthma attack occurs in your dental chair when you're treating a patient, how you're going to manage it. First, look for the signs and symptoms. Provide an inhaler immediately to the patient. Mostly the patient will be carrying an inhaler with him. A short-acting beta-2 adrenergic agonistic inhaler like Ventolin or Proventil, even this can be used, that salbutamol can be prescribed for such patients. However, it should be short-acting beta-2 adrenergic antagonist inhaler, because a long-acting one will take time to get the expected results. In the case of a severe asthma attack, subcutaneous injections of epinephrine 0.3 to 0.5 ml, 1:1,000, or even inhalation of epinephrine has to be provided, because this is a fast-acting method for relieving the bronchial constriction. The supportive treatment to be provided in these patients include oxygen, repeated bronchodilator doses as short as every 20 minutes. Monitor the vital signs of the patient and make sure that the oxygen saturation should reach at least 90% or above, and emergency should be called for if required. Now, coming to the renal disease and the periodontium, when you talk of renal diseases, what we can keep in mind is the chronic renal failures. Renal failure is defined as a progressive disease characterized by a gradual destruction of nephrons and a consequent reduction of kidney function occurring over a few months or years. And as this process develops, the glomerular filtration rate falls when the serum levels of urea increase. Now, what is a glomerular filtration rate? It is basically a test used to check how well the kidneys are functioning. That is, it estimates how much blood passes through the glomeruli each minute. And we know that the glomeruli are the tiny filters in the kidneys that filter the waste from the blood. Basically, this glomerular filtration occurs due to the pressure gradient in the glomerulus. Increased blood volume and increased blood pressure can increase the GFR, whereas constriction of the efferent arterioles coming into the glomerulus and dilatation of the efferent arterioles leaving the glomerulus will decrease the GFR, and the normal GFR values are expected to be in the range of 120 to 130 ml per minute, but it can vary according to age, gender, and body size. Coming to creatinine clearance level, the reduction of GFR is usually measured by the creatinine clearance level. Now, creatinine is a waste product that comes from the normal wear and tear of muscles on the body. Just like GFR, even the creatinine levels can vary depending on the age, race, and body size. It is said that a creatinine level of greater than 1.2 for women and greater than 1.4 for men can be an early sign that the kidneys are not functioning properly, and as the kidney disease progresses, the serum levels of creatinine increase. Now, you have 5 stages of chronic kidney disease, that stage from 1 to 5. 1, 2, 3, your more of a periodontal treatments can be carried out without much problem, but you have to be careful in patients who are in stage 4 and stage 5 kidney disease, that is severe decrease in GFR and kidney failure. So the causes of chronic renal failure include hypertension, diabetes, glomerulonephritis, autoimmune diseases, etc. And the manifestations can be severe electrolyte imbalances, cardiac arrhythmias, pulmonary congestions, prolonged bleeding, etc. The general considerations for treating these patients include, as I said earlier, stage 1 to 3, there is not any major contraindications, but patients with advanced kidney diseases, stages 4 to 5 will require special considerations regarding their hypertension, anemia, risk of bleeding, infection, the various medications that they are using. Always consult a patient physician before starting treatment. Monitor the blood pressure. See that the laboratory values of the various blood counts are within normal levels. Again, patients should definitely be motivated about the maintenance of good oral hygiene, and as far as possible, only the conservative periodontal treatment should be carried out, preferably confined to non-surgical treatment if possible. Again, avoid long appointments. It can be frequent recall visits, and avoid nephrotoxic drugs in such patients. Now, dialysis is a life-saving intervention that has significantly prolonged the life expectancy in young patients. Today, we have hemodialysis and peritoneal dialysis, which is regularly being done in a lot of patients. Now, what is the treatment protocol for patients undergoing dialysis? See the first column, that is, take into consideration the assessment of the patient's oral hygiene, do a complete peridonal charting, and then proceed with phase one therapy, that is, supragingival and subgingival calcium removal, etc., and even a root planing and curettage. Do surgical therapy only if you are expecting a good prognosis in these patients. Otherwise, proceed with extraction. And most importantly, motivate the patients about the importance of maintaining a good oral hygiene, and the patient should be on a strict supportive peridonal therapy recall program. Renal transplant is said to be one of the medical miracles of the 20th century, because there are today thousands of patients who are suffering from chronic end-stage renal disease whose quality of life has improved with a renal transplant. So when you talk of renal transplant patients, we have to be careful about the pre-transplantation case and also after transplantation. So pre-transplantation phase, if a patient needs any peridonal treatment, thorough medical history, drug history, a chemoprophylaxis, that is antibiotic prophylaxis, should be done in order to prevent systemic infection, that is 2 grams of amoxicillin orally 1 hour prior to the procedure. If patients are allergic to penicillin, you can give clindamycin. And in a case of an active infection like peridonal abscess, that antibiotic therapy has to be given before and after the dental therapy. Keep in mind, after the transplant is over, these patients are at great risk for getting an infection. So any antibiotic prophylaxis, which antibiotic should be done, should always be done in consultation with the patient's doctor. Emergency dental therapy, if at all required, should be performed only in the hospital environment with the consultation and consent of the treating nephrologist. It's always better that you wait for at least 6 months after the transplant is over for doing any peridonal surgical procedures. Now, if at all you are doing peridonal treatment in these patients, plan the treatment in such a way that it incorporates many sessions. A few teeth can be scaled or root planed during each session. And also, since these patients are on immunosuppressive drugs, check for any oral lesions that may occur. And keep in mind that cyclosporins can cause gingival enlargement. So therefore, a thorough oral examination is required. Liver diseases. Patients on end-stage liver diseases, NSAIDs may be tolerated only in mild chronic liver diseases, but in cirrhosis patients and end-stage liver diseases, NSAIDs should not be prescribed. Even in alcoholic liver disease, excessive bleeding may occur with end-stage alcoholic liver disease. So, such patients may need vitamin K or platelet or clotting factor replacements. Monitor BP at all times, that's because portal hypertension can occur in end-stage liver disease. Now, the dental management of patients with neurological disorders, allergies, and rheumatoid diseases. But neurological disorders nowadays are commonly seen because you see a lot of patients, but keep in mind these patients are at high risk during dental treatment because complications can occur like stroke, MI, adverse bleeding, altered consciousness, etc. And the most common neurological disorders include stroke, Parkinson's disease, Alzheimer's disease, epilepsy, and multiple sclerosis. Now, we'll just briefly touch on each one of these conditions. Stroke is a generic term used to refer to a cerebrovascular accident caused by a serious and often fatal neurological event caused by sudden interruption of oxygenated blood to the brain. The patient will show the signs of hemiplegia, temporary loss of speech, unexplained dizziness, loss of vision, unsteadiness, and sudden fall. How do you manage these patients? Avoid use of metronidazole and tetracycline because these patients will be taking warfarin sodium. Analgesics, you can use acetaminophen, but avoid the use of other NSAIDs. Get good pain control with a proper anesthetic procedure. Keep in mind these patients will be on anticoagulants, so they are at increased risk for bleeding. So use measures that minimize the hemorrhage. BP should be monitored throughout the procedure. Chair position, there's no definite contraindication, but keep the position chair in a position in which the patient is comfortable. Stroke patients, preferably only emergency treatment should be done within the first 6 months. Short appointments, stress-free appointments, and during the treatment, blood pressure and oxygen saturation should be monitored. Coming to Parkinson's disease, today we see a lot of patients with Parkinson's disease, especially with the aging population. Of course, this is not related to the aging population alone. There is even juvenile Parkinson's disease that can occur. The oral manifestations include patients with excessive salivation, drooling, decreased frequency of swallowing. In all these patients, usually the maintenance of oral hygiene becomes difficult because of the muscle rigidity that occurs. And many of these patients, the drugs used to manage this condition often results in xerostomia, which again leads to dysphagia. So salivary substitutes and topical fluoride should be prescribed for these patients. Even dementias and Alzheimer's disease. Now, dementia is a syndrome in which there's a deterioration of cognitive function. In these patients also, usually the maintenance of oral hygiene will be poor, and the patient will be on various psychiatric medications which can contribute to the development of xerostomia. Mucosal lesions, candidiasis, plaque and calculus buildup, Peyronie's disease can also be seen in these patients. So in general, the management of these patients, that is the patients with Parkinson's disease and Alzheimer's, there's no need for antibiotic prophylaxis, but to achieve good pain control, if anesthetics, epinephrine 1:1 like concentration is well tolerated, chair position not a problem, but many of these elderly patients may not be comfortable with a supine position, so probably you may have to go for a semi-supine or erect position. Many of these patients old will be anxious, so measures should be taken for stress and anxiety reduction. Even medication should be given if required. Keep in mind, both these category of patients will be on anticholinergics like atropine. So this patients on atropine may have adverse effects like sedation, drowsiness, confusion, etc. This should be kept in mind when we are treating the patients. And rarely emergencies can develop, but keep these patients have to be regularly followed up for the next 2 to 3 days to see that there are no complications occurring. Coming to epilepsy, epilepsy is defined as a group of disorders characterized by chronic and recurrent paroxysmal changes in neurological function. It results in altered consciousness or involuntary movements. It can be caused by abnormal and spontaneous electrical activity in the brain. The oral complications include gingival overgrowth, anterior labial surface of maxillary and mandibular teeth are affected, traumatic injuries due to fall, etc., such as broken teeth, tongue lacerations, and lip scars. Now, coming to management of these patients, generally, even chair position is not a problem, but these patients will be anxious, so appropriate anxiety medication should be given. Keep in mind, these patients are on anticonvulsants. Again, these anticonvulsants can have adverse effects like drowsiness, dizziness, slow reaction, etc. And be prepared for occurrence of a seizure in the dental chair, preferably then immediately put the chair in supine position. You can even put the patient on the floor if possible. Elongated mouth prop can be provided. And during an emergency, clear the area, avoid aspiration, and passively restrain the patient. And most of these conditions are self-limiting. However, if you feel that the condition is progressing and it can even go for a cardiac arrest, immediately call for follow-up medical care. Rheumatologic disorders, it is a large group of disorders that affect the bone, joints, and the muscles. Today, we'll just talk about osteoarthritis here. So the rheumatoid arthritis, an autoimmune disease of unknown origin, characterized by symmetric inflammation of the joints, especially of the hands, feet, and knees. The oral complications involve the TMJ involvement, so there can be bilateral preauricular pain, tenderness, swelling, stiffness. Bony ankylosis can occur. An anterior open bite can develop due to the destruction of the condylar heads and loss of condylar height, and higher incidence of Peyronie's disease is seen in such patients. Management of these patients, keep in mind that bleeding can occur if surgery is performed on this patient, because these patients will be taking aspirin. So, but this usually this type of bleeding can be controlled by local hemostatic measures. Anesthetics, avoid NSAIDs. And another possibility is the possibility of allergic or lichenoid reactions, because these patients will be on many medications. Chair position, nothing specific, ensure a comfortable chair position for the patient. take a differential blood count of this patient before the starting surgery, because these patients may be on penicillamines, anti-malarials, or immunosuppressive drugs. And if the patient is on corticosteroid therapy, secondary adrenal suppression is a possibility. If bleeding occurs, you should have local measures in place to control the bleeding. Coming to dental management in cancer, cancer is characterized by abnormal growth of aberrant neoplastic cells, characterized by destructive invasion of tissues. Can be either direct extension or spread to distant sites through metastasis. Various types of cancer are there. We are not going into the details of it. Today we are just confining to oral cancer. It includes 90% of oral cancer is attributed to squamous cell carcinomas, and 9% arising from salivary gland tissues, and 1% from metastasis elsewhere in the body. Again, clinical acumen comes into the picture. This was a case which was finally diagnosed as carcinoma of the gingiva. So any abnormal lesions in the oral cavity soft tissue, we should be able to immediately spot that something is wrong. For squamous cell carcinomas, 80% pathogenesis due to multiple cellular abnormalities, exposure to carcinogens, etc., and 10% due to UV light exposure and immunodeficiency diseases. Dental management will include both pre-treatment care during the cancer therapy and management of the complications of radiation and chemotherapy. The pre-treatment considerations include maintaining good motivation, motivating the patient to maintain good oral hygiene, scaling and root planing, and surgical periodontal treatment if indicated. Oral care during cancer therapy, keep in mind many of the patients on chemotherapy and radiation therapy can develop significant oral complications. So it is imperative that all the oral infections are eliminated prior to cancer therapy. So during your radiotherapy and chemotherapy, mucositis can develop. So use mouth rinses, anti-inflammatory agents, avoid tobacco, alcohol, carbonated drinks, xerostomias, prescribe sorbitol-based chewing gum, salivary substitutes. Patient can also develop radiation caries, secondary infection, sensitivity of teeth can be there, loss of taste, osteoradionecrosis, and muscular dysfunction can occur. So these conditions should also be looked into and managed. Post-cancer treatment management, patient can be put on a supportive protocol like the SPT we have for periodontal diseases. Initially, it should be was 1 to 3 months the patient has to be recalled, but after 5 years, probably once a year is enough. Osteoradionecrosis is characterized by exposed bone that fails to heal following high dose radiation. This risk is highest in posterior mandibular sites and in patients who are smokers, because posterior mandibular site, we know, is more of cortical bone. Periodontal disease also enhances the risk, as also non-surgical traumatic procedures like curettage, etc. So you may come across conditions like this. As far as possible, see that take precautions to prevent osteoradionecrosis from developing. If at all it develops, then it is very slow process of healing. Last part of my presentation is on infectious diseases. Keep in mind, many of the infectious diseases are occult in nature. That is, they don't have specific signs and symptoms. So medical histories are often inaccurate or incomplete. Keep in mind, especially in today's era, when we are talking so much about infection control, every patient should be treated as though they have an infection, and the universal or standard precautions should be taken to maximize prevention of infection and cross-contamination. Viral diseases, the bacterial diseases, the prion diseases, and the pathogenic fungi and protozoan parasites should be looked into as diseases of infectious nature. So the guidelines for treating HIV patients, hepatitis patients, the same protocols are followed for even HIV patients also, any viral infections. If active stage, do not provide therapy unless it's an emergency. In the case of hepatitis, be in consultation with the patient's physician and see that the patient has recovered before carrying out any procedures. If at all emergency treatment is required, then the treatment should be done using full barrier techniques. I do not need not elaborate. In this era of COVID, we know everything about full barrier techniques, what has to be done. Disposable covers should be used to cover all the handles. All disposable items should be placed in a one-line waste basket. Treatment, all this should be bagged, labeled, and disposed of following the proper guidelines for biohazardous waste. Aseptic technique should be followed at all times. Minimize aerosol production and pre-rinsing is recommended. If at all a percutaneous injury occurs during a treatment of a hepatitis patient, then CDC guidelines recommend administration of hepatitis B immunoglobulins. If a patient has not taken hepatitis vaccine previously, even it can be administered. So these are some cases that you might come across in your regular practice. You can see HIV candidiasis, necrotizing ulcerative periodontitis. A patient with this type of lesion, immediately suspect that the patient is infected. The Kaposi's sarcoma, typical lesion that you can see associated with HIV infections. For tuberculosis patients, keep in mind that a full protocol of tuberculosis treatment takes as much as 18 months. So follow up the patient's history, take a full history, make sure the patient's treatment is complete, and only after getting a consent from the physicians, this patient should be treated unless it is an emergency. If it is an emergency, follow the full barrier techniques that we were talking about earlier. Again, clinical acumen, I'm talking, you see this tuberculosis ulcer in a patient, such type of lesions we may come across in our day-to-day practice, or of course, not very regularly, but if at all you see a condition, we should be able to at least doubt that something is wrong and ask for appropriate investigations. Now, COVID-19, nowadays, we are listening to average of half a dozen webinars and about 100 papers every day. So droplets and close contact are said to be common routes of transmission, and aerosol transmission is also another route. Clinical symptoms, patient complaints of fever, cough, fatigue, diarrhea, vomiting. Today, they have antiviral treatment, immunoenhancement therapy, convalescent plasma therapy, and auxiliary blood purification treatment. Now, I could not get any article regarding the peridonal considerations in COVID-19 patients, probably because it is new. Probably, I'm sure 6 months down the line, some papers will come out how to manage peridonal conditions in COVID-19 infected patients. So in summary of my lecture today, there's an increasing population of in our community who are look apparently well, but in fact, medically compromised. So we should be aware of it, because if you do not recognize the condition, adverse interactions can occur between these medical conditions and the dental treatment, and it can even be fatal if you are not careful. However, apply some sound general principles like the getting a thorough knowledge of the medical history of the patient, knowledge of the potential drug interaction, and knowledge of the management of medical emergencies, the risk of potential interactions can be eliminated. A good medical and dental interdisciplinary cooperation is a must in managing these patients. And it's not just the physician and the periodontist. It should include the patient's family, caregivers, therapists, and anyone else who is involved in the life of that particular individual. And most importantly, the patient, the periodontist, we should possess a good cognitive skill ability. I showed you the various pictures of the various clinical lesions. This will permit us to appropriate use of proper techniques and behavioral skills. But again, there's a saying that the eyes cannot see what the mind does not know. So a good theoretical knowledge is also essential to for us to be able to recognize these conditions. So the measure of success of a civil society is the measure of the degree to which the society can take care of those of its members who cannot take care of themselves. And dental care for the persons with medical disabilities is an example of this. Well, we know the age-old saying that proper oral health care can contribute significantly to a patient's quality of life. So these are the references. I just have given you a brief overview of things and the several disease conditions I have not touched, because in the short time I have available with me, I have touched only the common conditions. But you can go through these textbooks. They give in detail, especially Little JW book, even Scully's Medical Problems in Dentistry. Elaborately, they have given about the various medical conditions and the considerations to be taken in that. So thank you all. For a patient hearing, I had taken a full 1 hour, 30 minutes to 30, almost more than 30 minutes to finish the lecture. I'm sorry it is extended beyond what it is supposed to be, but the topic was so vast that it took so much time. And I'm happy that almost all of you stayed back as participants to listen to this lecture. Neeraj?
Thank you very much, sir, for a very elaborative lecture, because this topic in itself is so vast that to cover it in 1.5 hours also, it's pretty difficult. And thank you very much, sir. If you permit, we'll take few questions.
No, Neeraj, probably 2 or 3 questions, because I'm talking nonstop on 1.5 hours. I am short of breath. My oxygen oxygen saturation level seem to be low, and probably I'm having slight hypoglycemia also.
Okay.
So we can restrict to questions. Others can contact me later. Probably few questions.
Yes, I'll request students to just write questions to sir directly. Sir has given his email address. Just one question, sir. What should be prescribed in cardiac patients for pain management, as we have to avoid NSAIDs?
See, that's what I said. In this thing, I told no. Tramadol is one. I'm using a trade name now. Tramadol can be prescribed. Even codeine derivatives can be given in such patients, because NSAIDs. I think I elaborated about the NSAIDs. Now, what will happen with NSAIDs if NSAIDs are given in cardiac patients? Because it is said that the NSAIDs have a direct adverse drug reaction with this antihypertensive drugs. It then lead to actual increase in blood pressure, thus worsening the cardiovascular diseases. Literature even reports that concomitant use of NSAIDs with this angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors, the angiotensin receptor blockers, even the diuretics can even lead up to acute renal failures, hyponatremias, hyperkalemias, especially in elderly individuals. So NSAIDs are contraindicated especially in hypertensive patients who are on antihypertensive medication.
Thank you very much, sir. And I'll request the students, if you have more questions, sir has given his email address. So please direct your questions to sir. And we will sign off today, and we will see you for the next lecture, everyone. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, Neeraj, for all the help and support. Huh?